coming, everybody. It's wonderful to see, a bunch of new faces, which is a good thing. Those of you who have some questions about BUGSS, our actually main lab is down four doors. We don't usually use this space, but we had such a good turnout for tonight that we decided we'd need a little more space, a little more elbow room for people. We have a lot of things coming up in the next couple of months. July 12th, we start our Build-A-Gene course. Lisa Scheifele is going to be teaching that course. That's on alternate Saturdays. You'll actually learn some of the techniques that, in a small way, lead to some of the things that Dr. Glass is going to talk about tonight. We also have this iGEM competition, so those of you who are interested in participating in that, see Jesse Goldenberg. He's the leader of the BUGSS iGEM team, so this is the first year that community labs like BUGSS have been able to participate in this competition. It's an international competition. There's over 200 teams registered from around the world, and it's, for those of you who aren't familiar with it, you're given a set of basically genetic Legos, and the rules are impress the judges. Build something that impresses the judges. So we've got some interesting projects in the works there. Let's see, what else do we have going on at BUGSS?
Scholarships.
Huh? Oh, scholarships, right, yes. So tomorrow, if you're interested, if you've wanted to join BUGSS, but for some reason, the membership fee has gotten in the way. We've actually got, through Lisa, a grant from the American Society of Biochemistry and Molecular Biology that's sponsoring several scholarships. 3-month scholarships will allow you to participate in the Build-A-Gene course, iGEM, and other activities that we have at BUGSS. The deadline for that is tomorrow. So the application is up
Sunday.
On
Sunday.
Okay, sorry. 15th. The application is on the website, www.bugsonline.org. Fill it out, send it in,
takes just a couple seconds, and we love a lot of people to
right.
choose from.
Right, yes. afterwards, come down to the lab, have some refreshments. I'm going to turn it over to Lisa, who's going to introduce our speaker tonight. Thank you all for coming.
Tom did mention is there's an attendance sheet on a clipboard going around too. If you're new here, if you're old here, if you're already on our mailing list, please sign up anyway so we can get a good record of who's here. I'm thrilled that you're all here. I'm thrilled to be introducing our speaker, who is John Glass, who's the head of the Synthetic Biology and Bioenergy Group at the J. Craig Venter Institute down in Rockville, Maryland. Dr. Glass has an extensive background in the study of infectious diseases and bacterial pathogenesis. He's worked a lot in the study of the genetics of viruses and then of bacteria in the group Mycoplasma, which we'll be talking about a bit today, I'm sure. He was involved in studies of sequencing bacterial genomes, discovering what the sequences of bacterial genomes. And when he joined the Venter Institute, he became the head of this group, which had this, fantastic vision that we can not only read genetic code, we can not only understand what's already existing, but we could write genetic code. We could actually make and synthesize genomes. And I'm sure several of you heard in the news around 2010 when the Venter group, led by John Glass, demonstrated for the first time that we can actually synthesize DNA in the lab. We can actually write DNA and put it into a cell, and that cell would live, and that cell would actually use and function off of that DNA. I think you'll see from his talk, one of the most interesting things is not only at the Venter Institute, what they do in the lab, but their ideas and this idea of digitizing life, the idea that DNA is software that we can write, that we can program and create new functions in cells, I think is what Dr. Glass is going to talk to us about today. So welcome, thanks for being here.
Thank you, Lisa. All of that other stuff. The important thing that you need to know about me is I won the Halloween costume contest 3 years in a row and gave it up after I went as Steve Irwin with a crocodile, with a stingray through my chest too quickly after it happened, and they just didn't go with that because I had the plastic alligator. So, and I am, this is a first for me. I mean, I have spoken, you know, to all these places, but DIY biology, I'm dazzled by. You know, I'm going to show you what you can do with $40 million, but you guys are coming in on a shoestring and doing some astonishing things that I read about. But let's get into what we can do. So we'll talk about digitizing life and synthetic genomics as we move along. So this is our building in Rockville. This is Ham Smith's card. I think he's in California now. That's a Nobel laureate. He's 83 years old now, and at the lab, he is amazing. He works just all the time and works everybody, I mean, he just works everybody else to the ground. He works so hard, the young postdocs are just stunned. You know, outside of that, he's an 83-year-old man with his left turn signal on. but in the lab, he's amazing. And then we also, let me see the last one. This is our new building in California that Craig's office overlooks the Pacific. It's across the street from the UCSD campus. And so we synthetic biology is located both places. I'm in my last 10 days in Rockville. I have finally accepted the boss insist I move to California. So I'll be in synthetic biology. I mean, I'll be there in 10 days, but I have the same job. We don't travel back and forth very much. We mail samples back and forth, and we function as one group, and it's as much fun as I've ever had in science. And maybe after we're done, if any of you are thinking about, you know, especially you young guys, women, girls, everybody, thinking about becoming scientists, or even if you're old, I have taken a very convoluted path to my position here as opposed to the usual path. This is our building, and it's the world's first totally green lab where we recycle water, we make all our own electricity. So the engineers wanted to make us able to have the windows open, but biosafety level 2 labs in. What I want to talk to you first, so when I give talks, here's how I begin things. How many of you got vaccinated for influenza? This is the best that I have ever seen anywhere. In Scotland, I spoke to 200 scientists, and two people in the room had been vaccinated, an expatriate American and me. And microbiology departments, it's about 25%. So I am amazed. I commend you all. So, forwards. So, here's influenza virus vaccine, influenza virion. So for the last 60 years, we've made influenza vaccine the same way, pretty much the same way. There's global surveillance to look at changing patterns in influenza as the virus evolves to be a different pathogen every year. This is the only drug that twice a year, the WHO makes a recommendation based on surveillance, and they will say that this is the strain that they think will be, or the strains, the three strains, they think will be important in any given year. And they send the recommendations out to the vaccine companies who make a new formulation, a new variation of the vaccine that is comprised of viruses or parts of viruses from those three different strains. And they take those, they put them into fertile chicken eggs. And this is like a 6-month process. So in March for the Northern Hemisphere, they announced this so that the vaccine will be available in August or September, and then they do it again in September for the Southern Hemisphere. And the vaccine makers have to it is a race every year. This is how it's been done the last 60 years. Now, 2009, we had this pandemic thing. Now, we were lucky. We all heard the stories. 1918, it killed 2% of the world's population. In 2009, this pandemic was, so they declared a pandemic, This is when it was declared, and this is when the vaccine makers started making the vaccine. And you can see by the time they had significant levels of vaccine, the peak of the epidemic had already passed. Now, this time it was a mild, it turns out it was mild, but if it had been the 1918 strain, you know, every day that the vaccine wasn't available could have been tens of thousands of deaths. And the government vaccine makers would like to do something better than this. So again, years and years, this is how it's been done. But there have been, as a result of people working, doing the same thing, sort of thing I did in graduate school, trying to develop methods to work with viruses that were genetically, at the time, intractable. The virology community used really synthetic genetics to develop something that they call reverse genetics. So step one, some patient, they take a snot sample from some patient, they extract the virus, they will extract RNA from the virus, may reverse transcribe it to make DNA, and they'll sequence that virus for this strain. And the virus, influenza virus, has 8 different genes. 6 of them are for housekeeping genes to make the DNA polymerase and nucleocapsid proteins, but 2 of them, the neuraminidase gene and the hemagglutinin gene, these are the immunogens, the things that you want in the vaccine. And these are the things that really change from strain to strain. All right, so they take that, and what they can do now is synthesize, so from just the digital information of the DNA sequence that maybe was generated in Indonesia, we would sequence plasmids we would synthesize DNA for each of these pieces, and the hemagglutinin and the neuraminidase, this would be the ones that are really important. We make all these plasmids, and then we take that plasmid and transfect it into eukaryotic cells. And 3 days later, if everything goes as it should, we get this infectious influenza virus. Now, what this means is that you've gone from digital information to an actual viral particle. I should also mention that in the past, So in the past, what happens is, I'm not remembering my slides. Forgive me. So what we showed is that it is possible to, in basically 10 hours, go from digital information to have the oligonucleotides made, delivered to us, and digital information, we order the oligos, 6 hours later they're given to us, and 10 hours after that, we have made the synthetic DNA for this virus that we want to make. And then 3 days after that, we make the DNA, put it into mammalian cells, and 3 days after that, you have the first virion that will be used to make a vaccine. Now in the past, what would have to happen is that patient who had the infection, they would have to take his snot sample, they would have to infect mammalian cells or fertile chicken cells with that influenza virus. They would have to purify that virus, and then they have to take that virus and mate it with another strain of influenza that was adapted to grow in chicken eggs. Hmm. And so what you want is to get the 6 housekeeping genes from the egg-adapted virus, which is called Puerto Rico 8, and you want the 2 immunogen genes, HA for hemagglutinin and NA for neuraminidase, from the patient sample. And so it would take about a month from getting the virus from wherever it came from, Indonesia, China, wherever, of just constant effort to produce that first virion. Whereas what we were able to do is make the virus DNA, you know, or DNA copies of the viral genomes in a few hours, and in 3 days make the virus. And so this is, you say, okay, so 30 days, 35 days by the old method, and it says 5 to 7 days, but we actually did it in less than 4 days. 4 days to make this first virion. So in the case of, it takes a month off of the 6 month process it takes to make 100 million doses of virus. Now, and we did this test in collaboration with our partners at CDC and BARDA, which is Biological Readiness Preparation, and the Novartis Vaccines and Diagnostics. So in the summer of 2012, we did this test and showed that we could do it in this amount of time. On Easter last year, the Chinese announced that the H7N9 virus was beginning an epidemic in China. And they put the sequence on the web Easter Monday. By Easter Monday night, we had the DNA made and on a plane to our collaborators in Boston. And by Friday morning, we had what has become the seed for millions of doses, is my understanding, that the government has now stockpiled millions of doses of vaccine against this. And in the very near future, so Novartis has built this $1.3 billion BSL-3, in essence, biosafety lab in Holly Springs, North Carolina, where they will be using this to make their seasonal influenza vaccines. And so you're going to see that in the very real future, here's an example of synthetic biology touching everybody's lives. You guys are smart enough to go and get vaccinated, almost all of you. So this is an example of how this kind of science can really affect people's lives. So that's sort of my beginning to show that it touches all of us. But biotechnology is actually 3% of the U.S. economy now, which I didn't know. I was kind of stunned to learn. Most of that is detergents. but what is the heart of biology is this idea of DNA. And as Lisa said, we think of, so more and more biologists are thinking about DNA as the same way computer scientists think about ones and zeros, this idea of abstraction. And so the DNA of living cells is as the operating system is to a computer. And this synthetic biology idea that we've been able to read DNA for, so when I was in graduate school in the early 80s, you know, if you could do 100 base pairs of DNA sequence, they would, you know, not only would they give you a PhD, they would probably give you a Nobel Prize. Actually, Govind Khorana got that, I think, for work he did in the mid 70s. But DNA, if we can read it, now we can go beyond just reading DNA to actually writing things. We can think about making things to solve human problems. We won't just observe biology, we'll really be able to understand it, because you make a hypothesis, you think of how I might design something to do to solve some problem, to make my yogurt last longer, to make better crayons, to make a vaccine, and then you try it, you build it, and you test it. And this is our mantra now, design, build, test. And this capacity to understand biology at a new level will lead to designs that will lead to all these kinds of things that we think can solve human problems. Back to this analogy again. The cell is the hardware and the DNA is the software. The cell contains everything it needs to read the software. Now, what is driving my team at the Venter Institute now and has driven us really for more than a decade, and has driven a lot of biologists for a long time, is how do cells work? You know, we're organisms. It seems to work, but we don't really understand how things live. Now, cells evolved for one thing, to make more cells. This is what they're for. Our job is to make more humans. E. coli's job is to make more E. coli. And what we do, what E. coli does, is it takes chemicals and energy from the environment and we reproduce ourselves. So, not so much thinking about us, but if we're trying to use cells to do things, the goal is to redesign cells so that instead of making more cells, they will probably do that, but more importantly, they'll make things that will solve our problems or make great art or do what we want. But we don't know the design rules of how to do this, and this is what we're trying to figure out in my team. So, biology, physics is hard, right? I don't know if any of you took like pre-chem chemistry or took a lot of physics, but physics can be hard, and biology seems soft, but physics is simple. You know, basic rules, things follow the rules. Chemistry, a little bit complicated, but biology is unbelievably complex. And similarly, when you think about biology, as you go from simple to complex, enzymes, biological chemicals, are in some ways relatively simple, but viruses, you know, more of a few enzymes, cells, hundreds of enzymes potentially, tissues even more, organs, organisms, ecosystems, increasing complexity. So it has long been the dream of biologists, and in fact, even physicists and chemists who have been attracted to the problems of biology, are there ways that we can simplify, say, cells enough so that we can understand how they work? So Max Delbruck was a famous physicist in the 30s and on, and he formed this thing called the phage school, and their idea was first to try to understand phage. And there are a few, there are a few viruses that have a small number of parts. We understand how every one of those parts work. We really understand this. But cells, not so much. Now you think about, you know, bacteria, they're simple, right? Is that what you think of? E. coli has, what, like 3,000, 4,000 genes, depending on what strain you choose. And E. coli is certainly the best understood organism, the best understood of all organisms. But of those 3,000 or 4,000 genes, at least a third of them, we really don't know what they do. No idea. And E. coli is, this idea that the idea that they had is that maybe instead of we could make a cell or alter a cell so that it's simpler, this reductionist approach, so that if you knew what every part was and what every part did, you could model life better and then use that knowledge to do amazing things. As I said, PHYX-174 is a phage, and this was really the first phage that was really fully understood. It was the first sequenced DNA virus. It has been a storied workhorse in the history of biology. Now, we know what every atom does in this phage to some extent. Cells are vastly more complicated. Just pieces. This is a eukaryotic cell, a really complicated system. Coli, 3,000 genes, but there are organisms in nature that are much, much simpler. Now this is a picture of one of my favorite organisms. I like to refer to it as a marine bacteria because this organism called Mycoplasma genitalium was originally isolated from the urethra of a British marine in 1980. And it is the smallest, so it has the smallest genome of any organism that can be grown in pure culture. And this is what we thought we would use as a model for our minimal cell. So Craig and my colleagues sequenced this. This was the first bacterial genome that was, the second bacterial genome that was sequenced in 1995. And they were interested in this because, again, this idea that it is, if we can take this organism the way it is and strip it down even farther, so that it probably needs every one of its 485 protein-coding genes to grow in a human neurogenital tract. But we believe it only needs about 350 of those genes to grow in the lab. So if we can strip it down to that, And then under absolutely ideal conditions, so every gene was needed, and then we start understanding what each piece does, we may be able to model what it takes to be alive and use those lessons. So this is the theme of a lot of what we do. Now, genitalia proved to be just too hard, so we started working with a close variant of this called Mycoplasma lycoides. And this is another small bacterium, and as you can see, if this is E. coli, and this is a bacteriophage, Mycoplasma lycoides is pretty small. It is an opportunistic pathogen of goats, causes mastitis, polyarthritis, but most goats in the wild actually have some degree, I mean, they are to some extent infected. In the lab, if you put a beta-galactosidase gene in it, it makes these fried egg-like looking colonies. They're gorgeous, even without the blue from the beta-galactosidase, which is a protein that interacts with a chemical called X-gal to turn it blue. I'm guessing if you've done any cloning, you may have used this to distinguish false positives from positives. Makes this, you know, these nice colonies. It has a near minimal genome, minimum metabolic complexity, and it makes these colonies in a couple of days. So our first task was to figure out what genes are essential and what genes are not essential. So, you know, students, how many of you know what a transposon is? Okay. What's a transposon? Okay. What was your name again?
Marissa.
Marissa. You're the one who's supposed to be shouting this out. You're the one supposed to be embarrassing the old guys in the back of the room. So sometimes they're referred to as jumping genes because they will jump around. So the way we tried to figure out what's essential and what's not, we took a transposon that randomly will jump around in a bacterial genome, and we put a tetracycline, which is an antibiotic resistance marker in that gene, so that when it jumps into a gene that is essential, the cell dies. But if it jumps into a gene that is non-essential, what you get is a cell that is resistant to tetracycline, and so if you treat your cells with tetracycline, with the transposon, and then select for only the cells that survive after you treat them with tetracycline, you get a population of cells with these transposons in it. And then if you sequence out, so if you use sequencing primers to go out in both directions from this, you get an exact location of where the transposon went. And so you can use those data to say that some genes are essential and some genes aren't. And so, for instance, if you look at Mycoplasma genitalia and sort of a general map of genitalia metabolism, a whole lot of this organism we found out really wasn't essential. You don't need that much to survive in nature. And so we had our work cut out for us of what we were going to have to take away. Now, if I was working in E. coli, I could just take them away because we have great tools for E. coli and yeast and a few other bugs. But for some organisms, when we started this, we can do next to nothing. There's no capacity to make site-directed mutants. It was really, really hard to work with. And so this is in 2001 or 2002, that my boss, Craig Venter, who is known for being, the term you hear is maverick. I also hear that with Sarah Palin and John John McCain. But Craig is described as a maverick, and he said, okay, well, we don't have the tools to do this using conventional genetics, so let's just make a cell from scratch, and we'll just do that. And, you know, John and Ham Smith and you other guys, so I need you to do this. You know, I'm going to go out and raise money for this, and I will help you with the design and stuff, but make it happen. And so in 2003, by 2005, we had assembled basically a 25, 28 person team. And this is all any of us did for the next 7 years of our lives. The goal was to go from Mycoplasma lycoides to what we thought would be this minimal cell, this Mycoplasma laboratory. And we founded what we refer to as a branch of synthetic biology called synthetic genomics, where the idea is that instead of making one or two genes, we would do this on a grand scale. Whole genomes for viruses and bacteria and other organisms with properties that are unobtainable by conventional molecular biology methods. It went too fast. So this is sort of the punchline. This was the cover of Science in July of 2010. These are electron micrographs of what we refer to as the synthetic bacteria. And that's a short way of saying it is a bacterial cell with a chemically synthesized genome. So what we had to make, this wasn't the minimal cell, but before you make the minimal thing, we better figure out how to make a normal cell. Once you know how to do the normal, then the job is to make a minimal cell. And like I said, 7 years of my life, if I could, I would be infected with this. But I do have the T-shirt. I didn't find it. And I would, if I was willing to be tattooed, I would probably get it done, but I would want an actual size. So. So this is this notion, again, of digitizing life. We know what the sequence of this organism is. We made some design changes in it, and now we're going to build a thing. As I said, it's not technically a synthetic cell, but it has a synthetic genome. And to do this, we had to develop three processes that didn't exist when we started. So whole genome synthesis, the capacity to take a whole genome and park it in a yeast cell where you can make enough of it or manipulate it or do things you want, and then to take this genome out of a yeast cell and put it somehow into a recipient cell so that it commandeers this cell, and instead of the cell being green when it's programmed by its own genome, now you make a cell that is like this because it's programmed with your synthetic genome. These were the three technologies we had to develop. And when I was earlier in the organization, my responsibility was to develop this technique we call genome transplantation. And so we took mycoplasma mycoides, the idea was to take DNA from this cell, isolate it, purify it, and put it into this cell so that it becomes this cell. Now in nature, horizontal gene transfer occurs basically four ways. Transformation. So in the labs here, you take a plasmid, you either electroporate the cells or you treat them with some polyethylene glycol, and you can take plasmid, isolated DNA, put it into a cell, and that cell takes up that DNA and will express the genes that are in that plasmid. There's conjugation, which is sort of like sex between bacteria, where a donor organism will make this pili that it will send a single strand of DNA into the into a recipient organism, and so you get cells now that have this plasmid. So this is another way of transferring DNA. Sometimes viruses, so a virus takes a genome out, goes and finds a new cell, puts the DNA in, and that DNA will get incorporated into a genome. And then there is cell fusion, where you have two cells come together and the membranes dissolve into each other, and so you get a cell with two genomes sometimes. Well, we were trying to do something different. We wanted to be able to take a genome that's just floating around that might have a tetracycline resistance marker, and somehow we're going to, pardon me. Go away. Somehow we're going to get this thing into a cell by magic, and then we're going to restore conditions for growth to that cell so that you've got a cell that is transiently diploid. It'll divide, and then when you add tetracycline, only the cell that had your synthetic genome or your donor genome will survive. This was the plan. We had no idea how we were going to, we had a few ideas, but we weren't sure how we were going to get there. These are the organisms, so we chose these organisms. Mycoplasmas are hard to work with, but we knew that they had a number of properties. They were small, they don't have cell walls, unlike E. coli or yeast or most bacteria, so we thought this would make the process easier. And we took two organisms that are very closely related. So The first thing we had to do was somehow get a tetracycline marker from an E. coli plasmid into Mycoplasma mycoides, and we did this with a transposon. There was a young woman, a postdoc from France, Carol Lartigue, who had done some work like this in graduate school in Bordeaux, and when she joined my lab, she immediately started with this process, and then the next step is we had to learn how to prepare the recipient cells and install them. Now, Carol worked brutally hard. She came in and worked 6.5 days a week, and was there when I got there in the morning, was there when I left at night, and just day after day, for 2.5 years, she just pounded at this. Just everything you could think of, exploring condition space. And did brilliant work. I mean, every controls, everything, nothing was working. And one day she came into my office and shut the door and just sat down and started sobbing and saying, I've got to go home. I'm tired of this project. I want to go back to France. I just can't do this anymore. Give me another project. Give me something. I just can't stand it. How do you guys handle stuff like that? Anyway, I gave her a Kleenex and I said, yeah, well, go back to the lab and maybe you'll be better tomorrow. And the very next day, she comes in and her whole life changes. She showed me, taking out a BSL2, she brought in this plate that had this big, beautiful, colony on it. And from there, so this was one colony. It's hard to optimize zero, but from when you have one, then very quickly you can find ways to improve this. And very quickly she was getting thousands of colonies with each transplantation experiment. The whole project was moving forward. She had a first author paper in Science. Her husband, who had been having visa trouble, was able to come back to the United States and be a kept man because she was doing so well. Her life just started going great because I said, go back into the lab. So this is, we got transplantation going. Now the next thing we had to do was learn how to synthesize a whole genome. And first we tried this smaller genome to begin with. So transplant, and when we started this, so the biggest thing that had ever been synthesized was 31,000 base pairs. And we had in fact developed, so this was the field at the time that we started this, but we made better methods for 5X174 synthesis, and we tried to apply that to make a mycoplasma genitalium genome. And this was our plan. So 5X174 is about 5,000 base pairs, 5,800 base pairs. So we were going to design and synthesize and assemble 100 pieces at about 100 overlapping pieces of DNA, all synthetic, that would let us make this chromosome. So we would make 100 pieces, and then sort of like a NCAA basketball tournament, so we're going to take 4 pieces that are 5 or 6 kb, and they overlap like 200 base pairs. And we'll put them together to make 24,000 base pairs, and then we'll take some of those for 72, quarter genomes, half genomes, etc. This was the plan. And Dan Gibson, who was also another brilliant postdoc in my group, and if you've heard of Gibson Assembly, and if you haven't, I urge you, one of your goals in life is to have people sing songs about you. And there is a video by the Oxford iGen team where they actually sing songs about Dan. They have a video about Gibson Assembly. Go on YouTube. If I could get that woman to, she was an undergraduate when she did this, that young woman to come and be a graduate student in my lab, I would be thrilled to have her just because of her originality. Anyway, to assemble DNA. So when I was in graduate school, I wanted to take 4 pieces of DNA and put them together to make a plasmid. 2 years it took me to do that. So this was in the mid-80s. And remember, what you're trying to do, this was blunt end ligations, which means you've got, it's like you're taking 2x4s with no overlap at all and glue them together. Now what Dan said is, that's nuts. So what we're going to do is take a DNA that overlaps by a big piece, by like 200 base pairs, and we're going to use an enzyme we're going to use an exonuclease that will cut back from 5' to three prime. Okay? And it makes this part single-stranded. And then if you've done that for two pieces, now when you restore them to annealing conditions, instead of blunt end, which is really hard, or even a regular restriction enzyme, which is four bases of DNA, maybe, now I've got 200 bases of homology. And it goes together brilliantly. So my graduate student, Vanya Paralanov, when she needed to put 14 pieces of DNA together, she just PCR'd up 14 pieces, put them in a tube, added the enzymes, voila, the next day she had this plasmid. It was sobering. Anyway, so this was an earlier version of Gibson assembly, which has still been improved since then. And so what you see is when you take 4-5 kb pieces, or in this case, yes, 4-5 kb pieces, and you chew back, meaning the enzymatic digestion to do this over time with longer chew back, and you anneal these pieces, you start getting more and more of the 20 kb piece of DNA. And so we use this to take our 5 kb pieces that have been made from synthetic oligonucleotides to make bigger and bigger pieces of DNA. Now, synthetic DNA, you don't get a lot when you do these reactions. So what we did is we made these assemblies, and we put them so they've got ends that are compatible with a bacterial artificial chromosome vector, so that now you get these five pieces of DNA to go together, and then you transform coli with that. So it is fundamentally a synthetic piece of DNA, but you transform coli with that, and you get large, you can make gram amounts of the stuff, which you need to move on to subsequent steps. And this assembly of pieces of DNA, it worked actually up to whole chromosomes. We made 8th genomes and quarter genomes. So these are quarter genomes, we made 8th genomes, half genomes, 3/4, even whole molecules, as you can see from this. But it turned out that coli doesn't work really. Bacterial artificial chromosomes are good up to about 250,000 base pairs. But after that, you've really passed the limit of what they can do. So we moved on into yeast. And another postdoc in our group said, you know, yeast is an amazing thing. And if you mix alcohol, it makes bread. And it turns out it makes really big pieces of DNA as well. So Gwen Venders, postdoc in my group in the transplantation side, said, you know, we maybe can do it this way. And she took the 4/4 that were as big as we could make, along with a cloning vector for yeast, and threw them into a yeast cell, and amazingly to us at the time, it worked like the next day. And so we had made a whole genome. And here's like pictures in just almost a regular, it's a really good oil immersion microscope, but not a great microscope. And you can see this synthetic genome floating around just in a light microscope, because it's that big a piece of DNA. So you think, okay, we've got genome synthesis working because we've got transplantation working, we have synthesis working, and you think, okay, it's kind of like George Bush on the aircraft carrier. Mission complete. It didn't seem like that. So now we have to figure out how to go through a yeast intermediate. And because we knew that we had to go through this yeast intermediate because that's where we were parking the cells. We couldn't do it with BAGs. And we were concerned. So bacteria have an immune system. Anyone know what it's called? Has anyone heard of restriction enzymes? So bacteria use restriction enzymes to degrade foreign DNA that may come in the form of viruses. So if a virus, bacteria will put methyl groups at specific places at certain sequences. So like wherever you have a CCC GGG, it might put a methyl group on the cytosine. And so if unmethylated DNA comes in, the restriction enzyme that recognizes CCC GGG will cut that foreign DNA up. This is how bacteria have an immune system. But we're going through yeast, and yeast is more like us. It doesn't have that kind of immune system. And so if I take bacterial DNA here and put it in yeast, it's not going to be protected from any restriction enzymes that are here. So we were concerned about that. Moving along, So we had to work out ways to solve this and to do all these things. And what we, so here's an example. If we have DNA in yeast that has this CCATG site, and if it goes into a bacteria that has an enzyme that would kill that, then it's not going to work. So we had to come up with a way around this. And we learned that we can methylate the DNA in vitro using enzymes, or we can take an extract of the cells. We can take an extract of the recipient cell. An extract of the recipient cell and treat this DNA and methylate it in vitro. But we also, thankfully, managed to, even easier, we managed to make a mutation in this by random transposon mutagenesis. And we got that. And so now it seems to be, you know, we made it work. So untreated cells, you got no transplants. Whereas if you were going from untreated genomes, you got it. If I go from yeast into Capricorn that I didn't do anything to protect it, you got no transplants. If we had knocked out the restriction enzyme, we got transplants. If we treated the donor genome with extracts, we got transplants. It really proved our point that as long as you do the methylation, this will work. And so this is something that you really have to think about often when you're doing bacterial cloning or going from, even if you're going from yeast into bacteria. So we made this work, and this is, I hope I'm not going too long. This was important for a lot of things. So it's, you know, yes, it's a two-kingdom method for manipulating bacterial genomes, in that you start in bacteria, and you have a bacterial cell, and let's say I isolate that genome, and I use whatever method, there are methods to do this in vitro, to put a yeast piece of DNA in this, or I can transform both of them into a yeast cell, just a little snippet of yeast DNA that has homologous ends to the bacterial DNA. And in the yeast, they'll be homologously recombined together so that you now have a yeast. And on this marker, there is, in this little piece of yeast DNA, there is an antibiotic marker that will make it so that the yeast can only survive if it has this in it. So now I've got this in a yeast cell, and I can do anything I want to with it, with the amazing tools of yeast genetics. I can take pieces of DNA out, I can mutate it, I can add big pieces in. There's just the imagination, you are only limited by your imagination in terms of what you can do with yeast. You take it out of yeast, methylate it, transplant it into a cell, and I've got my engineered bacteria. Now, for coli, for Bacillus subtilis, I don't need this. I've got great tools to do these things. But for almost all bacteria, we have no tools at all. So if we can expand our genetic tools, and we haven't done that yet, so that I can take, for any organism I want to work on, I can isolate that, I get the bug, I isolate the DNA, which that is just, that's doable for almost anything. Isolate the DNA, get it in yeast, manipulate that genome the way I want to make a cell that can only grow in, or that will grow great in water with an oil spill, but it isn't on its own capable of degrading the oil. Well, now I put the genes in that will have it convert the oil into something innocuous. Or if you've got water contaminated with dioxin, or you want to do this in water that is 0 degrees or 100 degrees, you can mix and match organisms to do this sort of thing. This is the vision that I think it will be critical, not so much for synthetic organisms, but for making it possible to engineer the vast diversity of the microbial world. Again, organisms with poor genetic tools. So you insert a yeast centromeric plasmid into the, which is called a YCP vector, into the bacterial genome, put it in yeast, and then I can manipulate it any way I want. And then through genome transplantation, I get the modified genome back to have new properties. So now we have the final act. So we've now got the capacity to take genome transplantation. Not only can we do it for a bacterium straight into another bacterium, we can do it from mycoplasmomycoides straight into yeast, and then from yeast into mycoplasma capricola. But we've only synthesized a mycoplasma genitalia gene. And this is where Craig is again audacious. And he says, okay, you guys have been trying to transplant mycoplasma genitalia for some time, and it isn't working. Do I know if I had a synthetic mycoplasma mycoides genome, you know how to do this? And so he says, okay, at this point, it was still more than a dollar a base to synthesize DNA. But he said, go ahead, I'll get the money. We will synthesize a mycoplasma mycoides genome. And this is when Dan made his better Gibson assembly, which you can buy now, or but it's really easy to make, just with enzymes that you can order. And we designed a new genome. We started building the thing. And it was supposed to, oh yeah, Craig had to say, we should sign our work. You should, artists sign their work. So we said, we'll sign our work. And we made a code so that four bases constitutes a character. And we then wrote, so the idea is that we can prove it's synthetic, identify the laboratory of origin, and not only are we going to do this, but we're going to be clever about it. So first we wrote the names of all the authors, and then we wrote some things that make us seem philosophical and deep. So we have this quote from Ulysses, James Joyce's famous book, and when the Joyce estate found out about this, they threatened to sue us, but it hasn't happened. This from Robert Oppenheimer, things are not as they are, but as they might be, from American Prometheus. And he was the father of the atomic bomb, but a philosopher of science also. And then the mantra of synthetic biology, what I cannot build, I cannot understand. So we wrote this in the DNA, along with a website, so that if you figured out the code, you would write us and we would say, congratulations, you filled out the code, figured out the code. And within hours of the publication, people had figured out the code. But actually, we now, there are like almost 150 people in the world who have taken the time it takes to decode this. We should really have something better to do, I think. Anyway, we thought we would have this thing on Christmas Day in 2009, but remarkably, we didn't. And after struggling and struggling and struggling, it took us weeks, we realized that we had made a one base error in the synthesis. So there was one base missing from the first gene in the genome, and the genome was dead from the moment we tried to do anything. So once we fixed that, then on March 24th, we got these beautiful colonies, and we had electron micrographs made, examples of colonies again. We got the cover of Science. People all over the world, as Lisa said, it was big news, at least for scientists all over the world. You can even see The Economist. This is not a picture of Craig, but there was a lot of parodies of this. And this is what we think is a really big moment in biology, because we have made a living cell. We have shown that you can go from, not only with the viruses, but into the digital world and back with cells. And I think it also shows that our capacity to build microbes, at least capable of solving human problems, is only limited by our imagination and the laws of chemistry and physics. So now we're starting to build this minimal cell. And it is going really fast. So as I said, what we found is that the organism has about 480 non-essential genes, 280 essential, and 143 conditionally essential. We are building this thing from the bottom up. So first we did a best guess based on transposon mutagenesis. We have synthesized the genome in 8 pieces based on this information. And we set some rules up for how we're going to do this. You're not supposed to memorize these. We designed the genome. That's the wild type, but this is our redesigned genome, or reduced genome design, that is this size. And we have synthesized the thing, and we're putting each of the 8 overlapping pieces into a otherwise 7/8 wild type background because we're logical people and odds are we've made mistakes. But if we can start with something that is only 12.5% synthetic and the rest natural, we will see if that piece of it is good. Now, to our great delight, what we found is that all of the 7/8 wild type, 1/8 minimized segments work. And so here you can see some electron micrographs of this. And you notice that these puppies here, they look different. This one I understand. There is an enzyme called FDSZ, which is responsible for how cells make a septum when they divide and sort of pinch each other off. RGD5, I don't understand. And it is still a little bit mystifying to me that cells can live without FDSZ, but it clearly happens. So these are the things that we're now starting to put these pieces together in hopes that when you combine them, they will work. Although the first time we have done this, they haven't worked. We're going to have to be modifying this yet again to try to deal with some problems that we have found. But we are beginning to learn the rules for designing genomes. Now, Craig Venter will, at his seminars, will show this, saying that we have this program to design genes, but in reality, it's just, it doesn't go much farther than this. I'm sure to design organisms. But we are learning how to do this. Even though cells are unbelievably complicated, as I said, and even a minimal cell, it's still a lot of moving parts. There's a lot of it that we don't know what it is. There's dark matter in these cells. And this is one of the things that we hope to learn from this project. So how to make these machines work. So we're finding that some proteins that you think you know what they do, turns out they also do something else. It's called moonlighting. And this has been an amazing discovery that has stunned a lot of the microbial science community. You see a protein conglomerate of several enzymes that you just don't understand. Like, you know, here is this complex of proteins is isolated, and you don't understand why some of these things are there, because the way we think of it as what we think we're smart biologists, they have nothing to do with each other, but there they are. So this is the challenge, one of the challenges that we're looking forward to with this. I have a collaborator at Stanford who, even with as little as we know about cells, he said, we're going to take what we know about Mycoplasma genitalium and we're going to build a model of this organism with 28 computer programs that are linked so that the idea is you can design a cell or you can understand how cells work, even though a third of the genome, he has no idea what it does. And he built this program, which I'm betting probably isn't going to run, but what he did is it will model the one cell cycle of growth for this organism. And what we found is that he's able to predict. So I gave him 100 mutants, gene knockout mutants in this, and for 70 of them, he was able to predict whether it would grow faster or slower. So we are getting closer to the point where we're going to be able to design cells. So where do you think we're going? As I said, we can think about moving life into the digital world and back. Limited by our imagination, this idea of bringing engineering principles to biology, design, build, test, learn, design, build, test, learn. This is the new mantra of biologists, and we've learned this from engineering. DNA synthesis, when I started science, it was about $16 a base, when I first tried to buy synthetic DNA back in 1999, it was $16 a base. At a meeting I was at yesterday in Denver, they were talking about being able to do this for 2 cents a base today and 0.1 cents a base next year or the year after. So although we can make DNA in our own labs, at some point it just won't be worth the effort if anybody can buy DNA, although it's still kind of fun to do. There are companies that will provide big pieces of DNA that are validated, and you can do what you want. And you can use robots to put things together. At this meeting I was at yesterday, there was a company called Amaris, which is a remarkable, it's like 6 years old, and their idea, this was the real first synthetic biology company. This is a plant they have in Brazil where they take sugar, sugar cane, and they make all of these chemicals that are conventionally either unmakeable or they can be made from intermediates from synthetic biology using yeast to produce this key intermediate that is so important for so many different chemicals in fuel and fragrances and other products for the chemical industry called farnesene. Now farnesene is in some ways similar to the oil that you get from sharks. Now sharks are being consumed now and wiped off the planet for reasons other than getting the oil, but this is still an example of synthetic biology replacing something that is taken from large animals by doing it with microbes, or by replacing something that is made from the petrochemical industry and doing it with microbes. What's on the horizon? So increased understanding how life works. DNA synthesis is going to be basically free. So I can make at 0.1 cents a base, and that won't be the bottom, I think, of where prices go. That will be $1,000 to make a million base pair genome. Now that's not what I think your group is thinking about, but it will still change the world for a lot of us in terms of stuff. Industrial chemicals will be synthesized in micro refineries as opposed to things that you see on the way to New York, in New Jersey. Natural products as a source of new pharmaceuticals, new sources of energy, and material science is just going to be amazing. The idea, so I have a friend who's now trying to make spider silk the size of beams. Stuff like that. At this meeting yesterday, I was truly stunned at things that people were beginning to show that they can make using at least small amounts of now in the lab, and there will be more and more examples of these fermentation facilities where they take huge amounts of sugarcane or corn stover or stuff like that and produce chemicals. There's a lot of fermentation capacity left, even in the U.S. now, from people's companies who have gone bust in the ethanol industry or who knows, that could be turned into refineries for new industrial chemicals. There's also, probably you guys have seen this. How many of you have seen this? This is, there's some issues with what we do, right? Is it ethical? So there is a French artist who had a friend who was a biologist who engineered luciferase into a rabbit, into stem cells of a rabbit, and made a bunny that would glow. A lot of people are incensed at this. It just seems wrong. I'm not so worried from an environmental perspective, because if this bunny got out, I don't think it would have that much luck trying to escape predators in the dark. And I've had, like, high school kids, when I've talked to high schools, they'd ask, could I get them one in purple? No. But synthetic biology is really intent on its interaction with society. So genetically modified crops, it hasn't gone so well for them. The environmental industry, I'm sorry, the environmental movement, in many places thinks this is the worst thing that ever happened. Do any of you know the book, The Whole Earth Catalog? Stuart Brand? So I was at a synthetic biology meeting a couple of years ago, and he's like the after dinner speaker. And he comes up and I'm thinking, oh my gosh, he's gonna lay into us. And he says, we were taught in the environmental movement, the first thing to say is no. Well, it turns out, genetically modified crops are probably the best thing that could have come to agriculture. And he was talking about, this was pre-Fukushima, but he was talking about nuclear power is probably about the cleanest way we're ever gonna get energy. We got so many things wrong, and he was just extolling the virtues of this modern approach. Now, the genetically modified food industry or plants, they really didn't anticipate the backlash that they would see. And so we're really trying to get ahead of this, so to let people understand what we are able to do, what you will be able to do working at BUGSS here to change things, and we're looking at legal issues and ethical issues. We're trying to engage engineers and biologists. We're really trying to do this in a smart way. And part of it, I think, is your community. If you look at the capacity to synthesize DNA, so as I said, tRNA in the mid-70s would get you a Nobel Prize. This will get you a PhD back in the early 90s, probably. And then there's the things that we've made. So you look at this, you see two bacterial cells, a bacteriophage, a virus. Now, if you look at it in that context, it changed how the world viewed synthetic biology a great deal. People became afraid of us, but I think that that's waning a little bit as they're seeing that it is really, there is an increased understanding that, that making terrible pathogens, we're not likely to do this even if we intended to, and no one really knows how to do this if they tried to do this. It's much easier to go to a hospital or a barnyard and find pathogens than it is to make them. And so there is more and more of, but still we are trying to think about this and get ahead of the issue. Even back in the 90s, my boss commissioned a study of religious people, ethicists, lawyers, politicians, to talk about the risk of minimizing, of making a minimal cell or making, or making a bacterium, and they thought that there really wasn't one. But there is still these concerns about societal issues, bioterrorism, safety, harm to the environment, distribution of benefits, that's a hard one, and ethical and religious concerns. And there are a lot of communities in this. DIY, people like me, governments, social scientists, environmentalist citizens. Bioterrorism is a big concern, and a great deal of energy is being put into this, but the chances that one of you would make a bacterium or a virus that accidentally was really dangerous is really hard. There is a vast difference between doing E. coli or yeast or algae and doing mammalian cells or doing virology. So no one, I think, could stop state-sponsored terrorism, but individual microbiologists, for the most part, I'm not too concerned about, and I think most people aren't, although someone with my particular skills could be dangerous. I don't like the notion of, you know, if we solve this by killing all the biologists. Laboratory safety, a bigger concern, but more that, you know, I think here, if someone was trying to make, when I was in graduate school, I needed to do an experiment that I needed T1 phage. And I really didn't do my reading about T1 phage, and I made like liters of the stuff. And when an expert in this came and he said, "Are you nuts? If you had dropped a flask of that, basically no one at the University of Alabama at Birmingham would be able to do anything with E. coli ever, because the T1 would just spread all over the campus." So I autoclaved it all. But there is a chance of doing something stupid like that, but it is more that you're going to mess up other people's work. The difference about synthetic genomics, of course, is the speed and scale of what you can do, and that you make something and it might go on to evolve. There are studies that are being done to look at this. This was one that our institute did, suggesting options for governance of synthetic biology, which we came away with. Basically, the plan is that, for instance, none of you could order dangerous influenza neuraminidase genes from a DNA synthesis provider. They should flag that and stop it. 4 years ago, that's right, the President's Commission on Bioethics came out with a series of recommendations about synthetic biology, and they found fundamentally that it is safe if practiced with care, and there were a bunch of recommendations about how to do this better, and they're aimed more at economic competitiveness and doing this in a way that will help American industry. So it has all of these recommendations. There are guidance for makers of double-stranded DNA. So if I should be working on influenza, I can buy influenza genes, but ordinarily people can't. Just like you can't go and buy botulism toxin unless you're a cosmetic surgeon or something. concerns about the environment. DNA, synthetic DNA itself, probably not bad. It's just DNA is DNA is DNA. And people have been mixing DNA. We make horses and donkeys. Gregor Mendel mated different kinds of peas. We've been doing this on a random basis for a long time. But our community, I think, is trying very hard to be sensitive to this. I don't think you can demonstrate any real good cases of harm to the environment from genetically modified organisms. I mean, I would challenge you on that, but that's a concern, something. Distribution of benefits, that's a tough one. If we are mining the developing world for sequences of enzymes or things that we might want to build into new products, if they don't have the skills and technologies necessary to take advantage of these things, is it fair for us to do this? So if influenza comes from China or Indonesia, are they going to want to give us the sequences so that we can make vaccines if they don't get those vaccines? This is the sort of thing. Societal concerns. There is hubris. My boss has been accused of playing God. What's different? It is different, but it's still, you know, it's a great time. Things are moving fast, and the community itself, I think, is trying hard to have this be something good for the whole world. Sure, there are chances for things to go wrong, but even with language, you've got Shakespeare and also Bible. I'll start with that. This is, I think, life by intelligent design. My boss, Clyde Hutchison, who was one of my professors in graduate school at Ham Smith, Nobel laureate from Johns Hopkins. And it's a whole pile of us who are working on this. Got any questions?
Expression of genes outside of living organisms, so that, for example, you could set up a process in a plant that would, you wouldn't have to sort of suck in the genetic material into yeast or into bacteria. You could just express it through setting up the right environment.
Yeah. So it is. So it's something that's done on a small scale routinely.
Okay.
Where you will take. So. You can take E. coli cells, and I can lyse them, isolate the cytoplasm, treat the cytoplasm with a RNase to get rid of the endogenous messenger RNA. Then I treat with EGTA to suck up all the calcium, back new messenger RNA, lots of it, so that I have the cells just making what I want, and you can isolate small amounts of things that way. Now, there are more and more groups who are trying to do this on a grand scale,
right,
where it is possible to make, especially for really high-value chemicals, or to understand how things work. And in vitro science has long been done, even back when I was in graduate school in the 80s, we did a number of things in vitro process, but it is even, there are those who think that rather than have cells to make energy, it might be better if we just made huge amounts of the enzymes necessary to catalyze reactions and don't do it using biological organisms to do this. You have biological synthesis of the parts, but having it done all in vitro.
Yeah. Thank you for that. The other question I was curious about, maybe a science fiction scenario, but let's say that I'm synthesizing a DNA because I want, you know, a perfume, or I want a chemical for some other to make a certain property of plastic looks like. And so I'm playing with the genetic sequence.
Mm-hmm.
What are there scenarios where these new artificially generated genetic sequences might be sucked up by a virus and then might have some, might cause some problems, might create sort of a properties that, you know, we haven't planned for, prepared for, or anticipated?
That's certainly possible.
Okay.
Now, we've got to remember that, so viruses that infect eukaryotes use very different signals than viruses that infect prokaryotes.
Mm-hmm.
So the signals that lead to transcription and translation in prokaryotes really don't work in eukaryotes and vice versa. And there are a number of other safeguards. A lot of what my colleagues in synthetic biology are doing right now is to develop safeguards just to make sure that these things can't happen.
Yeah, and it's really not just whether they can attack mammals, because if you killed all the yeast in the world, that would also be a problem. I mean, more bread, no more booze. You know?
we might all be less happy, but live longer because of this. Although, it would be cheese, it would be, there would be other things. Yeah?
Can you describe the disciplinary diversity of your team? I mean, does everybody come from a sort of a similar biology background, or do you have some folks doing the computational end, some folks doing the wet, sometimes doing the, I mean, I'm just curious to see how that
is. So we have, most of us are biologists. We have computation, but I have people who are computer programmers. In my basement right now, I have a physicist, physics graduate. it sounds bad. This sounds really bad. So I have an MIT physics graduate student whose lab, he has a physics lab at MIT. We are set up for BSL2 work. And so in the summer, he's going to live in my basement. And I'll pick him up on the way home tonight from here. But he is doing experiments. And we're teaching him biology as he goes along, and he's teaching us stuff about physics. I collaborate with a number of physicists and chemists. Ham Smith is an MD. And Clyde Hutchison was a chemist. And then we have people, so my training was in eukaryotic biology, and we have yeast biologists, we have bacterial physiologists, I've got an ecologist on the team. But it is, we don't have any engineers. We had a chemical engineer for a while, but she quickly got hired away.
Mm-hmm.
So it tends to be very diverse.
I was wondering if you would talk a little bit more about your professional biography. You mentioned that you took a kind of non-traditional route to where you are now. I'm just curious about that.
So I finished undergraduate school not knowing what I wanted to do. I really like the idea of marine geochemistry. I was pretty sure the MBA wasn't going to work for me. And I also like bacteriology. So I, first of all, filled out job applications in pencil no one wrote back. But then I did it all typing it and worked and ended up getting a technician job for 4 years to try different things. And from there, I went into graduate school. And floundered in graduate school for a while because I didn't really know the difference between a good project and an impossible project. And so 9 years later, I graduated in the last 6 months, the project that I started with at the beginning of graduate school, but wasn't possible at the beginning, and was possible 9 years later. And then I did a postdoc in an entirely different process. And then did another postdoc and became research track faculty at the University of Alabama at Birmingham, and then went to the pharmaceutical industry for 5 years, where I was working on antibiotics and things. And then when the pharmaceutical industry, which has largely gotten out of the antibiotic business because there's no money in it. If you think about it, if I would have to take Propecia the rest of my life in order to not be bald, but if I get a strep infection, you take a Z-Pak and you're done a few days later. So there is more money to be made in chronic diseases than in antibiotics. And these are companies whose job is not to, to solve society's ills. First, they've got to make money. Anyway, Lilly got out of antibiotics and most companies did, and they went to the Venter Institute. And I went just because I think I was the old guy, but not so old that I have to. I sort of became the leader of the group and have been doing just amazingly different things, things that are wildly diverse, and it's been really fun. But whereas most people will undergrad, graduate school, postdoc for 2 to 4 years, where you are for most people, it's the most fun part of their career, where they don't have the responsibilities of being a professor or an assistant professor, and they don't have the fear that a graduate student has, which it'll just all go away and I won't graduate and I'll have to go home and live in my parents' basement, or my basement. But most people, I would sort of go through this standard process, but it's not necessary. There are a lot of ways to be successful in this. I have a number of friends who have gone from pharmaceutical industry back into academic positions or vice versa. And then I have friends who finished graduate school and went straight into government. I met a young man yesterday. He was a Harvard graduate student who's going to defend his PhD in a few weeks, and then he's going to a consulting company. He says, you know, I'm done moving small amounts of liquid from one tube to another. I want to make more money, but I'd like to just read about science and offer advice, which is fundamentally what I do now. I rarely, they only let me in the lab if it's something that no one does anymore. Maybe he'll know how to, or stuff on high shelves. But it's, there's so many ways to do science, or just to go home and like try to make a better aquarium for your tropical fish experiment with different algae. I haven't done genetic modifications of stuff in the tank, although I've always been tempted to. So what brought you to this?
Oh, finding my way, I suppose. Considering going back to school, molecular biology, looking for places I could kind of get my hand in, really like to find one in my backyard. Mm-hmm.
That's cool. I mean, you know, I have a lot of my friends, scientists, they make beer. Yeah. Other questions? Yeah.
I was wondering, I understood that you, in the project, you inject genetic material in the recipient's cell. Has there been any attempts to do something with mitochondria? I've always been curious about mitochondria.
So, mitochondria, we wanted to do this, mm-hmm. and it was conventional wisdom that the human mitochondrial genome was unclonable, for instance. Mm-hmm. Just was unclonable, but I didn't know that. Dan Gibson didn't know that, and he was looking for something to make. So he got the synthesis for the mouse mitochondrial genome, and a couple of weeks later we had it. And we were doing it in yeast as opposed to bacteria. And so we keep threatening to start a project where we'll try to transplant these synthetic genomes into mitochondria, but the literature all says that this is unbelievably hard. You can transplant genomes into lower eukaryotic mitochondria, but mammalian seem to be very hard. Similarly, I can move genomes into chloroplasts, which are another organelle. But mitochondria, there's so many, the shell of mitochondria so far has been impermeable to making this go. But if you could do that, mitochondrial gene therapy could be a wonderful thing for a lot of different human conditions that are bad. Maybe you can figure out a way.
Oh, I wish.
So the answer is no, I can't. But I really want to. Yes?
So I'm not sure I can keep the species straight, but your laboratory strain that you made with the synthetic. Mm-hmm. So over time, what happens to that genome over time? How stable is it? You see differences, different sets of changes that you see in sort of wild type? Is there non-randomness to that? Or?
So if you make a, you maybe have seen, there are these trees of bacteria where they will take all the bacteria and put them here, and the distance from the center is sort of an example. example of how far these things have evolved. And it turns out that the mycoplasmas is like a bump like this, and everything else is like this. So the mycoplasmas, because they have poor repair mechanisms, are evolving really faster than anything else. Now, we have been growing, we've been passing. And one of the things we're seeing is the cells are starting to grow a little faster. Now, part of that is mycoplasmas, these organisms, their job as a pathogen, your job is not to kill your host, it is to live comfortably with your host. And so they try really hard to avoid immunological surveillance. A big chunk of the genes that we're taking out are involved with immunological evasion. And some of the things we take out also result in a faster growing organism. So we're seeing subtle changes. And sometimes we've made a change, and the organism will make a compensating change that restores growth. So we're seeing movement. We're not, we can't afford to sequence that often, but we do sequence.
Do you see duplications?
No, because these organisms are under, mycoplasmas started out as organisms like Bacillus subtilis or Streptococcus pneumoniae or Staph aureus, with genomes about 2 million base pairs. And because of their parasitic existence, they have been able to throw away large amounts of their genome. And they seem to be under intense pressure to get smaller genomes. So if you take the three smallest bacterial genomes of any organisms we know of, it turns out they are all from the human urogenital tract. 700,000, 600,000, and 580,000. So my bet is if you were to go to the zoo and swab the urethras of a bunch of animals, you might find some things that are even smaller, because the genomic economy is very important to these particular organisms. So I could see if we were to grow these things in laboratory environment long enough, we would likely lose even more genes. But I don't think we don't have the time to do this on our own, and so we're trying to speed up the process. No doubt, as we do this, we will find there are different ways to get to the same minimal cell. And then once we have this minimal cell, we will start using tools to understand, like, there are likely about 400 genes that we have to have in this. And 100 of those, we have no idea what they do. But when we compare them to the rest of most bacteria, or even to most eukaryotes, we've got most of these same genes ourselves. And we don't know what they do in us either. But they have to be there. And so that's the fun of looking at this really simple system, is hopefully we can do this in a way that it's not one gene, one pH, one graduate student, one PhD, but we can really get an idea of how cells work at a better level than we've ever had before. And with the minimal cell, there's not so much other stuff that complicates your view. This is the beauty of a simple system.
So right now you're at eighths?
Well, we will probably stay at eighths, at eight pieces. But each of those eight pieces has been reduced by a factor of two. So we've gone from 78,000 base pair pieces to now it's enough. If what we have made is successful, we'll find out in a few weeks, and you'll read about it in a month and a half or two. If we're successful, we think we'll come up with something that's about 550,000 base pairs. So about half the size of the original genome. And that could probably be made smaller, but as you start going smaller, it starts growing really slowly. And that's just a killer. If it takes 3 weeks to make a colony, it's technically more minimal, but it is not as useful to work with. Who wants to do an experiment where you put it in the incubator and you come back 3 weeks later and find out if your idea worked or not? I want instant gratification, or even 2 days is close enough, having work with this organism that takes 3 weeks. But yeah, we work with it in eight pieces. we're now exploring mixing pieces of DNA from other organisms to, in some cases, see. So you, one of my colleagues, there was a gene that we had no idea what it did, but it looked similar, a little similar to something that we did know what it did. So just on a lark, Clyde took a Bacillus subtilis gene that has been chemically, biochemically characterized, and we replaced this MMYC361, we replaced it with this Bacillus subtilis gene, and the Bacillus subtilis gene did, you know, it went in and it showed us that, that gene, we didn't know what it did, really was the same thing. And so this is one of the tricks that we'll use to better characterize what's going on in these cells. But stuff didn't deteriorate. There was one really cool thing, though. We made a mistake. So there was, like, you know, this gene is essential, right? And there is so we have a tRNA gene, and there is a tRNA terminator here. So, you know, transcriptional promoter, terminator, right, for the tRNA. And then there was a non-essential gene, and then there was an essential gene. And it turns out when we took this out, we also took out the signal that led to the transcription of this gene. And what happened is, after the organism grew just a little bit, there was a mutation in this terminator, so that when the RNA polymerase was moving along through the tRNA, it made the tRNA, and then it went on to go through this terminator and synthesize this. So there was a deletion of a couple of bases that we didn't intend to do, but the organism fixed this on its own, which I thought was kind of cool. And that organism grew a little bit faster than the wild type. Don't be scared. I think it was kind of cool. Yeah?
What do you suggest that a couple young high school kids that they want to get in this field do to get into this field?
First of all, if I was going into science today, I wasn't like a 60-year-old geezer, I would be going into material science, because there are so many amazing things that can be done. In terms of, as I said, I was listening yesterday about someone, you know, trying to synthesize spider silk the size of girders so that you can synthesize buildings, or make chemicals, making chemicals or making new pharmaceuticals. That's the kind of training. I would have really good user computational skills. A little bit of coding would be good if you could do Perl scripts or something. And good mathematical skills are important. And the main thing, though, is to seize opportunities. You just got to say yes. If you have a chance to go and do something, never talk yourself out of doing an experiment. Go and volunteer somewhere. You know, I'm getting ready to move to San Diego, but I've always got high school and college interns in my lab. And that's one of the great things I look forward to about moving, is as opposed to having, you know, I'm adjunct at the University of Maryland, as opposed to having students who have to come 45 minutes from campus. People can just walk across the street when I'm in San Diego. But find a lab or do something like this, and that will be your springboard. You'll learn if you like it. Because going to class to learn about science is nothing like doing science. And if you like it, get an undergraduate degree in something, English, science, something, and then go to graduate school or get a job and make yourself financially able. But just keep following it. You know, you don't have to follow the traditional path. But computational skills are really important. You know, if I wasn't going into material science, the human genome all these data are available. And the people who can do the most are the ones who can use, by computational tools, go in and ask questions computationally that will allow them to design wet science experiments that give them answers. Because biology is not just about moving liquid from one tube to another, but it's just do it. And find mentors at Hopkins, or if you live in Baltimore or UBNC, I know that there are a lot of people there who are happy to take people who are really enthusiastic about doing things, especially if you can do it during summer. Internships are harder to find, but if you can work out, I've had a young woman who her junior and senior year did 15 hours a week in my lab during high school, and she's writing papers now, and will be off to Penn in the fall. But do things. iGen is great. Be an iGen. Yeah.
On the engineering side of things, has there been a lot of synergy with energy technologies? And is there anything in particular that you think has potential applications that you're looking for?
I think it does. It is at some level. So James Peltier, my MIT colleague, who's hopefully at the lab getting amazing things done now. He is designing microfluidic devices to do reactions on a small scale. I met yesterday a scientist who used to be an adjuvant who developed DNA synthesis methods at Agilent, but she just left Agilent and founded a new company along with a physicist who did designing things in silicon, and so now they're synthesizing DNA on silicon as opposed to in plastic. And she was saying that the thing you get with silicon is, A, you can do it on a smaller scale, but I can control temperature perfectly, whereas with plastic and in microliter amounts, you can't, but in nanoliter amounts, you can really control reaction temperature, and they have rules for how to make DNA. But this is an example of that sort of thing. Or James, my MIT graduate student's advisor, they are making DNA, what they call DNA origami, where you can build devices out of DNA. You make code that will make blocks out of DNA, and you can build things, visible things out of DNA as a structural thing. So lots of things can be done. Imagine that you were making chloroplast or mitochondria that, instead of being biological, were inorganic. That would be nanotechnology mimicking what we do in life, in living systems.
Manufacturing chloroplast, you can think about renewable energy.
Yeah, I mean that you just like paint chloroplast on a roof, or in terms of in vitro systems. So if you identify critical enzymes in chloroplast, rather possibly than making cells that take solar energy, you develop surfaces based on biological materials that will do this without the need for biology, but just to mimic what goes on in biology, because biology has 4 billion years of evolution to find the best way to do things, and all we have to do is just make something that's like what's in nature. Yeah? So I'll say one more time.
After you got the synthetic genome from the yeast cell, can you be able to put it in a more complex cell?
I don't think so. I mean, I think I could put it in, but I don't think anything would happen. So what we have found is that a bacterial genome, the transplantation process, the farther you get phylogenetically from donor to recipient, the less likely it is going to work. Now, Jeff Boca at Hopkins just showed that he can make a synthetic yeast chromosome and has been able to move the synthetic chromosome into natural yeast in order to make a processed yeast. And I have projects going on now where we are trying to make human artificial chromosomes. Now, if you think, you know, what is this for? Well, imagine that I make a human artificial chromosome that has a synthetic centromere and a synthetic telomeres, and we put into it genes for, you know, there are people among us who have antibodies that are great at defeating HIV or defeating malaria. You know, some people do. So what if we identify great antibodies and we make a synthetic, you know, a human artificial chromosome that will synthesize 10 antibodies to malaria. And we grow that cell in tissue culture so that you are expressing these antibodies in some kind of HeLa cells or something. So now, rather than vaccinate people with conventional vaccines, what you would do is give them this that might solve that, so that they carry these antibodies around with them. Or if a new disease wanders out of the jungle, you know, it takes decades to make a new vaccine, with the exception of influenza. But if I can make antibodies that are effective against that disease, I can give that to someone who's infected, and the approval process for giving antibodies is basically, it's always approved, because it is just a little variation on a molecule that we all have. That would be a way of treating new and emerging diseases that might show up. So here's an example where we already are learning how to take artificial chromosomes from that look like human chromosomes and put them into human cells, maybe not into people, but at least into human cells in vitro. And they become, instead of a 46th chromosome, a 47th chromosome. Hacks. They're called hacks. Human artificial chromosomes. Other things are called hacks too. You guys are great. I like questions. Yeah.
Hey, have you any success or tried so your minimal genome using that as a platform for another metabolic pathway to produce something?
Yeah.
I mean, that's a goal.
Yeah, that's the sort of thing. So, you know, one of the things that we thought about is to take rhodopsin, which is harvest light. And it would just be a few genes to put that into our organism, so that would be a new way for it to make ATP. And another thing we're doing, so
you've done it, or you just
planning? We're planning to do this, but this is the idea of modularizing the genome. So right now, like, glycolytic genes are spread all the way around the genome. What if we were to just take them all, you know, take all the mycoplasma, mycoides, glycolytic genes, and we put them in one cassette, and the tRNAs in another cassette? Could we design a more rational genome that would make engineering faster and quicker? These are the sorts of things. We have been able to take a genome that is normally glycolytic, meaning it ferments glucose, and we have added a series of enzymes that enable it to produce ATP by reacting with glycerol. And so normally mycoplasma mycoides can't do that, but we've made a cell that can. I think so. You know, we start small. You know, the first computers weren't like the phones, like the computers in your pockets. They were monster things that were not so incredibly complicated. We're starting with something, the idea of engineering a cell that's really simple in order to really understand how it works, and the capacity to engineer. cells wasn't there a few years ago, but more and more, I think we're going to see that gene therapy is possible for some conditions. My boss, Craig, just started a company called Human Longevity, the Human Longevity Institute.
It's a big rush on
that. Huh?
It's a big surge.
Yeah, well, you know, and we've been having these seminars that are about people who study aging, and it's interesting, the only people who, you know, are always there are us old guys. You know, how many polyunsaturated fats should I, grams should I have a day in order to slow my aging down? Okay, and which one should it be? You know, those, it's not people your age who are asking these questions. It is people, you know, 70 and 80 years old who really want to know, who are really concerned about this.
I'm already asking.
Yeah, well, you're a smart man. You guys got vaccinated, so. Yeah.
Mycoplasma is in the human pathogenic. Yours is pretty reduced. How pathogenic would yours be?
Well, so the mycoplasmas that we work with, as I said, are goat pathogens. So a species of bacteria, if it's a pathogen, it's almost always just a pathogen for one thing. Now, we've taken out, so the genes that are involved in getting glycerol into the cell, we took those out, which were thought to be a virulence factor. We've also taken out pretty much all the genes that are known to be involved in mycoplasmas binding to goat respiratory endothelial cells. So my bet is that I could stuff a goat like a turkey, and it wouldn't do much to it. But I don't think we're ever going to have it declared non-pathogenic, because you're asking someone to stick their neck out and say something that we used to think of as a pathogen is no longer a pathogen. And oh yeah, by the way, it's man-made and synthetic. And Craig Venter signed it, so. Anyway, it is. I'm not concerned about that. This is, in any event, it would be, at most, it's going to cause really mild disease in a goat. Anyway, now, one of the things we're doing is a close relative of this organism called Mycoplasma mycoides mycoides is probably, so I have friends who've said it is the most important veterinary pathogen in the world for which there is no good vaccine. And in sub-Saharan Africa, so it is a plague, the plague of the cattle industry in sub-Saharan Africa. It is a, it was originally in the Netherlands, it's gone from Europe, but in sub-Saharan Africa, where cattle maybe shouldn't be anyway, it causes something called lung plague, and the cows don't do it. And they have a vaccine, but it really doesn't work, and all you know is that the vaccine, if a cow's been vaccinated, probably its tail has fallen off. And so there are no tools for genetic manipulation of this organism to make a better vaccine, but we're trying to use our tools to do this. Now, one of the things we want to do is engineer into the organism a kill switch. So let's say you make a live organism that you infect the cow with, and the cow's immune system sees this long enough to develop immunity, but after the organism goes through 100 generations, it dies. And you might build a triple redundancy of kill switches into it so that, you know, let's say it was successful in 999,000 out of a million. Well, if you've got three of those, now you're getting to really effective systems. But this is the sort of thing that we're looking at now, of trying to apply this technology to solve a real problem.
Is it susceptible to conventional antibiotics?
It is, but it readily becomes resistant to tetracycline. And this is a part of the world where, because of conflict and because, you know, treating your cow with antibiotics is expensive. If there were a cow in Spain that showed up with this organism, they just kill the whole herd because they don't want it here. It's not in the Western Hemisphere at all. But in places where it is hard to get in and vaccinate cows, or obviously it's hard to get in and treat cows, the tendency is if your cow has Mycoplasma mycoides, just to kill it. So. yes, tetracycline would work, or, you know, I could give it chloroquinolones, but that's awfully expensive to treat a cow with these things.
So, is it 100 generations, that's kind of a slightly arbitrary number, or is that 200
hours? Well, I could set it like a clock.
Yeah.
So, every time the cell divides, it, you know, it drops, and every time that the genome replicates, it might drop off one base. And so, and when it gets, when that fuse gets to the end, it starts a cascade that kills the organism. Now, we haven't done that in mycoplasmas, but it has been done in other systems, and we would imagine porting that over. And there are other things we can envision doing this, so that imagine you had a mutant that it was only able to live so long as you provided something else that it can't get in nature. Probably would. I don't know if you could have it count forever.
Well,
but we picked 100 just sort of out of the blue as something, and that was a nice easy number for demonstration. This has only been done in laboratory experiments at this point, but it is being developed with the intent of a biocontainment system.
Good for commercialization too.
Yeah.
Since if you only have to do it once for the rest of the world, the rest of the time it's not very commercial.
Or, well, also, if I've got an organism that, let's say, you know, I want to, I can give it to you to use for something, but then you've got it for so long and then it dies.
Right.
So now you have to come back and buy it from me again.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
That's like Monsanto's Terminator seeds, yeah. Mm-hmm. Which, if you think about it, it's a great idea. And it seems very reasonable. Huh? Well, but...
Not so good for the farm.
But it's also good in that if you make things that you don't want to make with other things, which is, that was their intent, I mean, that was part of their intent in this.
So, I'm sorry, the one that's just been done in the lab, mm-hmm. that's really, it's the timer is this one base pair per generation?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So we have a hygiene product.
I have not seen it in a paper. I have seen this at meetings. So you may be able to find this any day now.
But
I don't know when this would go.
There's one for more ambitious
a base pair or a chunk of DNA at a time.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I know there are a lot of iGen projects have been aimed at developing kill switches. Thank you for all the questions. Yeah, please.
So I come from more of a computer science electrical engineering background. And one of the things that I kind of look at is the interface between biology and electronics or computer mm-hmm. systems. Is there anything being done now that kind of links some of these bacteria as sensors to electronic systems?
Yeah. Things that would produce electrical signals. If you have sensors that produce electrical signals, sensors that make, so you have an organism that if it sees cadmium, it glows a little bit, and then it is in a device that would measure that glowing and alert, is connected to connected to the internet, so you know that there's cadmium in your water. I saw an example of that yesterday in a group from a guy named Jeff Hasty, UCSD, where he has made these little devices that will monitor 10 different chemicals in water. Organisms are designed to glow if they detect cadmium or lead or zinc or something in the water. And then it's connected to a device with little CCD cameras on it so that it would tell you, oh, you have reached the threshold for concern about this. Anyway, so.
Dr. Glass, we didn't spend any 250 man years designing this, but here it is anyway.
Thank
really
you very much.
Really appreciate it.
I will
it.
Cherish this.
They're
I bet they are. Because you like made coli that produced this, right?
Of course, sure.
Actually,
just don't add water to it.
Don't drink out of that thing.
you put in L broth and it turns into scotch whiskey, right?
In our dreams.